Respected President, respected my dear beloved Treasurer, and past President and past Secretaries, and distinguished members of Indian IMA Kodambakkam branch, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to welcome on 461 CMA meeting of Kodambakkam IMA branch. This CMA meeting is being conducted by our Kodambakkam IMA branch very successful manner. In this note, before we move on to the meeting, I like to call upon our treasurer to recite IMA prayer and physician prayer.
Greeting, sir. Physician's prayer. Dear Lord, thou great physician, I kneel before thee. Since every good and perfect gift must come from thee, I pray, give skill to my hands, clear vision to my mind, kindness and sympathy to my heart. Give singleness of purpose, strength to lift at least a part of the burden of my suffering fellow men, and a true realization of the privilege that is mine. Take from my heart all quiet and worldliness with the simple faith of a child. I rely on thee. Indian Medical Association prayer. May everybody be happy. May everyone of us see to it that nobody suffers from any pain or sorrow. I do not ask for crown, nor I wish to be in heaven or reborn. I only want to alleviate the suffering of those people who are burning in fire of sorrow. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Treasurer. I would like to call upon Dr. Sandeep, my Assistant Secretary, Joint Secretary, to carry on the further proceedings. Over to Sandeep.
Good evening, members. At the outset, I would like to welcome all for this 461st CME meeting of IMA Chennai Kodambakkam, which has been successfully going on. Now we have a good academic feast comprising of many specialities and with speakers with national and international recognition. First of all, I would like to request all the members to upload their attendance in the chat box so that it can be processed and for CME points. The first speaker will be Dr. V. Karpagambal. She's a consultant obstetrician, gynecologist, and infertility specialist, undergraduate from Madras Medical College, DGO from Institute of OBG MMC, DNB from Public Health Center, MRCOG from London, and fellowship in infertility. She's got AICC RCOG traveling fellowship in gynec endoscopy, presented many papers and posters in various national and international conferences. Her special interests being fertility, high risk obstetrics, gynec endoscopy. Now she will be talking on the topic maternal treatment of fetal arrhythmia. Over to you, madam.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for the opportunity. I really thank IMA Kodambakkam for this great opportunity. I'm going to share my screen. Can you all see? Is my screen visible?
Yes, madam. Very well, madam.
I will start. Yeah.
You can start the slideshow. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, now this is a case which I had seen in the pre-COVID era, but it's very interesting because my special interest is high-risk obstetrics also. The case is presented for its uniqueness and how we are treating the mother for the sake of the baby. Maternal treatment of fetal arrhythmia, timely diagnosis and intervention, it's a case report. So now let us just understand what are the basics of fetal cardiac physiology. The conduction system of the fetus is functionally mature by 16 weeks of gestation. Normally, it produces a rate between 110 to 160 beats per minute till delivery. But there can be variations. There can be fetal bradycardia, which we say it's fetal heart rate less than 110. Or during fetal movements, the rate can go even up to 180. Fetal arrhythmias are defined by deviations from these parameters. The prevalence of fetal arrhythmias is 1 in 1,000 to 1 in 25,000 pregnancies and have the potential to compromise fetal health. The overall perinatal mortality of fetal supraventricular tachycardia is 8% in non-hydropic fetus and 30% in a hydropic fetus. So the main point is that presence of hydrops that really determines the prognosis for the fetus. Now, indications for fetal echo. Usually, we do a 2D evaluation of the fetal heart during the anomaly scan by around 19 to 20 weeks. Most of the time, we will be able to see a four-chamber view and the outflow tracts, which is quite enough, good enough for a normal pregnancy. But if the four-chamber view and outflow tracts are not satisfactory, definitely there is an indication to do a fetal echo. So other indications are structural abnormalities, where you know, we can see a large ASD, VSD, tetralogy of Fallot, transmission of great vessels, all these things can be seen. Maternal congenital heart disease, because there is always a risk of the presence of congenital heart disease in the offspring also. Maternal diabetes, which is very, very significant in terms of cardiac anomalies. We say that transmission of great vessels is a pneumonic feature of uncontrolled diabetes in the mother at the time of conception. Connective tissue disorders, mainly SLE. We know that anti-Rho and anti-La antibodies are more, mothers with these antibodies are more prone to develop congenital heart blocks. Sustained fetal heart rate of less than 110 beats per minute, sustained fetal heart rate of more than 180 beats per minute, unexplained non-immune fetal hydrops, congestive cardiac failure, frequent and repetitive irregular heartbeats, arrhythmia-induced cardiomyopathy. We can also see the regional wall motion abnormalities also in the fetal echo. Now, when we do a 2D, we do 2D echo, M mode echo, and a pulse Doppler along with the tissue Doppler imaging. So now, coming to the types of fetal tachyarrhythmias, there is a separate entity called fetal bradyarrhythmias, which I'm not dealing with now. But because this case is for its tachyarrhythmia, so I'm going to talk about more of fetal tachyarrhythmias. Sinus tachycardia, SVT, is reentrant orthodromic atrial flutter, ventricular tachycardia, multifocal focal atrial tachycardia, atrial ectopics, and atrial fibrillation. Now coming to the clinical scenario, a 30-year-old lady presented to us. She was Gravida 2, Para 1, Living 1, previous full-term normal delivery. Last childbirth was 5 years back. She came promptly for booking at 8 weeks. Her booking weight was 44 kg, no risk factors at all. Uneventful previous pregnancy and no medical risk factors for the mother. Booking investigations were normal. First trimester screening for trisomies were negative. Target scan, no obvious congenital anomalies noted. 28 weeks, we do a growth scan for evolving problems, which is also normal. So far, the pregnancy had been very uneventful. At 30 weeks, she came for routine antenatal visit. Every time they come for an antenatal visit, we check the fetal with the fetal heart with the help of a fetal Doppler. So clinical examination suggested a small for gestational age fetus with handheld Doppler showing irregular rhythm with a heart rate of 170 to 180 beats per minute, which is a baseline I meant, increasing to 220 beats with fetal movements. So whenever we do what is called as acoustic movements, or we just move the baby. So when we move the baby, the heart rate went up to 220 in the Doppler itself. The couple were counseled about the possibility of fetal arrhythmia because the rate was very irregular. So she was referred to Fetal Medicine Center for detailed cardiac evaluation. So for on evaluation, a scan, full biometry was done with growth and Doppler. Growth parameters were within the 5th and 95th centile, it's average growing baby. Doppler, both of umbilical artery, middle cerebral artery, were now within normal limits. Now coming to the fetal echo, the rhythm. The baby had an irregular, early irregular rhythm. There were runs of tachycardia at 220 beats per minute with 1:1 conduction noted frequently. The SVT would stop abruptly followed by a ventricular bigeminal pattern at normal rate. And in between, occasional AV blocks were also noted. So the impression that was given by the Fetal Medicine Center was supraventricular tachycardia, query atrial flutter with mild cardiomegaly. So the cardiothoracic ratio was 59% with mild tricuspid regurgitation, no pericardial effusion or hydrops, and no intracardiac anatomical defect. This is a picture of the reentrant SVT where from the sinoatrial node, it goes and again it comes back. So there is a reentry, orthodromic reentry of the rhythm. So now comes the main point, counseling the couple. The couple had been thinking that the pregnancy had been so far uneventful. Now telling that the baby has a rhythm abnormality, especially in the heart, the entire family got paranoid. So we had to really sit with them and talk to the entire family and counsel the couple regarding the management options. The first was delivery of the baby for postnatal management. Definitely not suited in this case, as the fetus was very premature and there were no impending signs of failure in the fetus. So there was no pericardial effusion and no hydrops. So this option was ruled out. Transplacental transfer by the antiarrhythmic drugs to the mother into the fetal circulation. This is the best option with a very good prognosis. This was highlighted by the couple in detail, and the couple agreed to go for this option. Direct administration of the antiarrhythmic drug into the fetal circulation. I will come to this a bit later. Observation of the fetus without therapy, not operate in this case, as there was mild cardiomegaly and tricuspid regurgitation. So the risk of hydrop is always there. The only problem with not treating such fetuses is that because of such an irregular rhythm, the hydrops could set in at any point of time. So it is very difficult to manage when the baby has hydrops. So it's ideal to treat the fetus because of mild cardiomegaly, which is a sign of impending problem. So now we come to the multidisciplinary teamwork. So the obstetrician, the fetal medicine consultant, adult cardiologist, neonatologist, and a pediatric cardiologist. All of us had a very nice discussion about how to go about this fetus and the mother and treat the mother for the sake of the baby. Management. Maternal treatment of fetal arrhythmia with maintenance dose of digoxin was planned at 0.25 milligrams 12th hourly with close monitoring of the mother and fetus. We opted for digoxin because digoxin, we know, is a time-tested drug, and many pediatric cardiologists are very comfortable using the digoxin for the mother for the sake of the baby. Good placental transfer, transplacental transfer. Because the fetus is non-hydropic, the transplacental transfer and the digoxin effect on the fetus will appear to be really good. So we opted for digoxin to prevent non-immune hydrops in the fetus and iatrogenic preterm delivery and its inherent complications. The couple were also counseled with the neonatologist and cardiologist regarding the in utero treatment of arrhythmia. The entire couple were, and the family were convinced, and the prognosis and need for postnatal treatment of the infant were also discussed if the arrhythmia persisted after delivery. So many a times we could see evolving problems or the problems becoming lesser as the baby grows bigger. But when there is a sign of cardiomegaly with arrhythmia, we prefer to treat because she was only around 30 to 31 weeks. So now maternal fetal monitoring. So mother was admitted in a tertiary center. Her baseline ECG, echo, serum electrolytes were done, monitored under the guidance of an adult cardiologist. She was started on tablet digoxin 0.25 milligrams 12th hourly. Her maternal pulse rate, ECG, serum electrolytes, and serum digoxin levels were monitored 8th hourly for early identification of digoxin toxicity in the mother. The main concern was maternal hemodynamic disturbances, which we didn't want because she was very small made, 44 kg at time of booking, and she had increased only by 6 to 7 kg in the entire pregnancy till date, and we were very careful about monitoring the mother as well. Mother was admitted for the oral digoxin treatment. Fetal monitoring was done by handheld Doppler, as CTG tracing could not be done. Because of the very erratic rate, CTG as a measure for assessing fetal well-being can never be done in these scenarios. So the fetal scan showed heart rate between 99 to 240 with trivial TR, but no mitral regurgitation, no effusion, and no hydrops. The most favorable thing that we noticed was the cardiomegaly had reversed. Even though the fetus had a very mild cardiomegaly, even that had reversed to normal ratio. Now follow up. The digoxin dose was increased to 0.25 milligram thrice a day with monitoring the mother, hoping that the fetal heart rate would settle down and we could gain more time to avoid a preterm delivery. Maternal ECG showed ventricular bigeminy and serum digoxin levels very marginally above the normal range. So this was one of the main reasons. Actually, we admitted her for 48 to 72 hours, monitored all the parameters in inpatient, and once the serum digoxin levels settled down, were within the normal level, she was sent home, and she was actually under the guidance of a cardiologist and myself, and we actually had a very detailed discussion about all the parameters. All the reports on WhatsApp, and we had a very nice communication with her. So the serum digoxin levels increased to just 2.1 nanogram per ml. Still, we were a bit worried, because she being a very thin patient, we didn't want to overload her with the digoxin. And even though her potassium levels were normal, we tried to bring down the day's dose of digoxin to 0.25 milligram twice a day and maintain at that level, because the baby was also showing some kind of an improvement and definitely not worsening. So other antiarrhythmic drugs of choice would be considered if the fetus had shown signs of worsening were sotalol, fluconazole, adenosine, amiodarone. There are actually quite a lot of drugs available. Verapamil, procainamide, quinidine. So a lot of things are available, but these are the most time-tested ones. So now the treatment of choice, as in our case, fetal SVT but no high drops. The first line of drug is digoxin. Then if this, there is no conversion to sinus rhythm or the ventricular rate does not decrease, the next option would have been sotalol. And sotalol can be increased up to 80 milligram per day for 3 days with a maximum dose of 160 milligram in 3 divided doses per day. But fortunately, in our case scenario, we never had to change from digoxin to other drug because digoxin was doing a fairly good job and the ventricular rate was actually kind of maintaining with no evidence of progressive tricuspid regurgitation or cardiomegaly or pericardial effusion. What if the fetal high drops had already set in? This is a big problem because when the fetal high drop sets in, the transplacental transfer of the maternal drugs to the fetal circulation is always a doubtful thing. So in that case, we can try digoxin intravenously or fluconazole. If there is no increase in digoxin with maximum doses, amiodarone could have been tried. Or if both these drugs don't work, the best option would have been for a direct fetal treatment. So considering the, this is not a scenario which we did, but there are cases where with high drops, direct fetal treatment would be necessary. Like it could be an intramuscular injection of the antiarrhythmic drug or intraperitoneal, or it could be an intravascular one. There are a lot of complications because these are invasive procedures, and especially with amiodarone, there could be a fetal exsanguination when the drug is injected into the umbilical vein. Now, this is the most important score I would like to mention. This is called fetal heart failure risk assessment. This is called cardiovascular profile score. In this, we take into parameters, 5 parameters, high drops, venous Doppler, heart size, the cardiac function, and the arterial Doppler. In our patient, most of the parameters had all the good score, like 2 out of 2, except the heart size and the tricuspid regurgitation. So initially, she had a score of 8 out of 10, and later, actually, till delivery, she was maintaining a score of 9 out of 10. Now come the most important decision in obstetrics, decision to deliver. Prematurity versus in utero treatment. She was almost 34 to 35 weeks when we really tell them, how long to prolong, when to deliver, because she had a previous normal delivery, whether to do a repeat, give her a normal delivery again, or to do a repeat elective cesarean section. So as she was nearing 36 weeks, we decided not to start on any new antiarrhythmic drug. Antenatal corticosteroids were given for lung maturity. Elective cesarean section was planned at 36 to 37 weeks with close maternal and fetal monitoring. The couple were counseled that fetal monitoring is very difficult during labor and induction of labor was deferred. So usually, even if they had a previous normal delivery, they would get into labor mostly after 37, 38 weeks. But we are contemplating on inducing by around 36 to 37 weeks where we don't want the fetus to be compromised and where our NICU setup are very, very good in handling such babies, even though they are borderline preterm. So this is the CTG trace. I just want to mention because it's so erratic and really cannot be used as a tool for assessing the fetal well-being. It gives us no clue of the fetal well-being at all. Maybe there are other parameters where when the membranes are ruptured, we can use the fetal scalp electrode or intrauterine fetal body cardiac monitoring, which are definitely not in use in our clinical practice in our country. So decision to deliver. So we had taken the decision to deliver by 37 weeks as an elective cesarean section, even though she was a previous normal delivery. At 35 weeks, 5 days, at 3:30 a.m., she came in labor with grade 3 meconium stain amniotic fluid. So that prompted us, but definitely the fetus is in distress. Usually meconium staining is not common in preterm because of the immature gut, but still she had a grade 3 MSAF and fetal heart rate varied between 70 to 210 beats per minute. So emergency cesarean was done. She delivered a boy of 2.27 kg with an Apgar of 6x10 and 7x10. Thankfully, the neonatologist and cardiologist were present at the time of delivery at 4 a.m. in the morning. That's very like an obstetric practice. So this is a neonatal ECG on day 1 and day 2. So the ECG actually were very, very satisfying because the infant's initial ECG showed signs of bradycardia, which could have been the effect of maternal digoxin. It reverted to sinus rhythm with atrial ectopics, no pre-excitation. An echo was done on day one, or on the day of birth, which was also found to be normal. Atrial ectopics persisted for some 40 to 72 hours, but reverted to sinus rhythm by 10 days. After 6 weeks, the infant's ECG was normal. At 6 months follow-up, also the boy showed a normal ECG. So at the time of birth, the pediatrician and the neurologist took the entire battery of tests, including the metabolic parameters, to see what could be the reason for the irregular rhythm. But none of them gave a clue about why it happened. Coming to discussion, fetal arrhythmias, they are a significant cause of non-immune high drops and intrauterine fetal demise. Whenever we think of sudden stillbirths, unexplained stillbirths, we really do not know why these babies die, even after evaluating for all the available causes for intrauterine fetal demises. So most common type of fetal tachyarrhythmia is reentrant SVT, as in this case, followed by atrial flutter. The progression of arrhythmia to cardiac failure is highly unpredictable. That's the most important thing. So which baby will develop high drops, which baby will not develop high drops is always a question mark. And high drops can set in at any time. Significance of assessing the rate and rhythm of the fetus by handheld Doppler during clinical examination in an OPD setting by listening to the fetal heart rate for full minute. It is a lesson that we all learned during our post-graduation days that even by listening to a fetus, which used to in our institute practice, our assistant professors and professors used to tell us, listen for full 1 minute. Don't just listen for a few seconds and stop. Tell that the fetal heart is good. But I think it's a very important point to make sure that we will be able to pick up rate and rhythm abnormalities just by listening to the Doppler for full 1 minute, which can definitely give us a clue about these kind of impending problems. Treatment of the mother with normal cardiac hemodynamics without any complications to her was very challenging because the couple were very unhappy because the mother was a very highly potent drug like digoxin, which we normally would not give for a normal person. So for the sake of the fetus, they agreed to take treatment, and mother was very, very, very cooperative in this situation. Now coming to take home messages. Fetal arrhythmias can be accurately identified by prenatal Doppler and M-mode echo and pulse Doppler. Identifying the electrophysiological mechanism of fetal arrhythmia is possible, useful in selection of the suitable pharmacological drug. So in this case, very clear, the entire team agreed that digoxin should be the first choice. And thankfully, digoxin worked very well for this mother and the fetus. Early fetal pharmacological intervention has a great chance of success in most of the fetal arrhythmias and has a good prognosis, even with early high drops. Even with early high drops, definitely these antiarrhythmic drugs do very well. Maternal health should never be compromised for the sake of the fetus. So in this situation, the maternal monitoring was very intense. We had ECGs for the mother, definitely. During admission, she had every 8th hourly. And once the digoxin levels settled down, she actually used to come every 48 hours to our hospital for taking an ECG. Now, these are my references. I had taken reference from a lot of the journals, and this Donald School of Textbook of Ultrasound Obstetrics is really a very ready reckoner for any ultrasound diagnosis or doubts. And thank you so much for your patient listening. I know it always, we are all very happy, very grateful to our entire team, and teamwork makes the dream really work. I'm very happy to answer the questions. Thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thank you very much, Sarpana Ammal madam, for the nice and detailed presentation of your case report. Now the house is open for discussion. Any doubts, please, you can ask.
What are the causes of supraventricular tachycardia generally? Does it occur just at de novo, or usually would there be any identifiable cause?
Many times we will not be able to identify because many times it can be idiopathic, sir. So actually that is what a big point here. When we think of arrhythmias, we see, we would like to, in adults, we have a lot of causes. The ECG is so informative, but in fetus, it's very, very difficult. And many a times these abnormalities are identified during a routine echo, or there are some other causes like, the non-immune high drops, which can cause these arrhythmias cause, definitely we don't have any particular reason why this VTS developed a supraventricular tachycardia.
But what are the usual causes? Or most of them are without any cause?
In our practice, when we see in SR, we see these rhythm disturbances in mothers with connective tissue disorders, which are one of the reasons for non-known high drops. But usually, my clinical practice, I've not seen any major cause. Even for non-immune high drops, when we evaluate, usually we don't see any major causes. And definitely, immune high drops, we know what is the cause. But non-immune high drops, very, very difficult. Sometimes these anemias, thalassemias, hemoglobin, they also cause non-immune high drops. But specifically for SVTs, we definitely don't have any major, I have not come across in my practice specifically for SVTs, sir.
Thank you.
I think the voice is somewhat feeble, so the speakers can speak a little bit closer to the mic.
Okay, sir.
I think she did not use a microphone. Many people use a microphone and headset. Okay. Probably she was speaking directly into the computer.
What happened is quite a lot of your words weren't heard fully. Just the beginning was heard and the end of the sentences weren't heard properly.
Actually, there was a noise coming in between, sir. I didn't understand. Then, I'm not using a microphone. I'm using directly on my laptop.
It's okay, madam. It was a good lecture. Only thing is, I wanted to say this. You know, there is at least the future speakers will avoid getting into this problem.
Dr. Eril, next time when we send the mail to speakers, we can tell them to use a microphone.
Sure.
Or a headset. That's what we will do.
Madam, can I ask one question? Can I ask one question?
Sir, please go ahead, sir.
This fetal arrhythmia can be incidentally sometimes say it is not detected all the time.
Yes, sir. Yes.
The supraventricular tachycardia also, it will occasionally come and then it will disappear.
Correct, sir.
When we do a fetal Doppler, at that time may not be seen, but when it is presenting for you, when you are doing manually, at that time you will detect it.
Correct, sir.
Yes.
So many a time, that is the main thing, sir, because many a times these problems can get, even if the rate had not been very high, and the fetus had not developed the tricuspid regurgitation or cardiomegaly, actually silent observation could have been enough. But because there was a cardiomegaly and the fetus had mild tricuspid regurgitation, we did not want high drops to set in. So we started treating, and the fetus was extremely premature by 30 weeks. That is the reason, sir. For example, in terms of term pregnancy, if we identify 35 weeks, there are case reports where the fetus have been just monitored. Every week they would do a Doppler and check echo and check the supraventricular tachycardia. And if it settled down, they will either induce or deliver. Not all arrhythmias. Sometimes they can be a transient process phenomenon also.
Thank you. Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you, sir. Thank you to the entire team for the great opportunity. Thank you so much.